Welcome to all of you who are joining us for our app webinar, a continuing series. And today's is going to be quite interesting. Crop circles, remote viewing, and resonance by Simeon Hine. And Sim has a He's the director of the Institute for Resonance in Boulder, Colorado. The institute is devoted to the study of subtle energy sciences, including remote viewing, crop circles, and related subjects. He has a PhD in sociology and has previously taught research methodology at Washington State University. He first learned remote viewing in 1996 and subsequently became involved in crop circle research. He believes that all crop circles, regardless of their origin, create magical effects by virtue of their shape and the subtle interaction between humans, plants, and sacred geometry. He's got these two books, Opening Minds, which I think is going to be the focus of today's talk. But also planetary intelligence. And with that, I'd like to give the presentation and the floor to Tim. So
Well, thanks a lot,
let's
Marty, and hi, everyone. Can you all hear me okay?
Yeah,
Sounded good?
we're fine.
Okay, great. Yeah, well, thanks for having me here today. I guess it's going to be a different type of meeting than you guys are used to having. It was great seeing a lot of you in New Orleans last month. And thanks, Marty, for having me here today. I want to give you about an hour presentation about my experience with crop circles since it came directly out of my remote viewing class with Courtney Brown back in 1996. I mean, this is where it all started for me. Believe me, when I first took Courtney's class in 1996, May, after reading his book Cosmic Voyage, I didn't know what a crop circle was. I'd never heard of such a thing. I was fresh out of graduate school. I'd been teaching statistics. I was an assistant professor, and I thought I knew how the world worked. I guess we all did before we encountered RV and all the related topics. But shortly thereafter, as happens, with a topic like remote viewing, I came in contact with lots of other topics. I got curious about lots of other topics. I began to meet lots of very interesting people at these RV classes because I was an instructor for Courtney, and very interesting people showed up there, people who had worked for NASA, who had worked in the military and intelligence agencies. And I began to see that there was just, a broader range of phenomena out there that I had no real expertise in, didn't know too much about, and being a curious person like all of you are too, I wanted to know more about this. So that is how I got involved in crop circles, and I will show you. Are you? I'll show you. Okay, I'll turn on my screen a second. I can see the message here. I'll show you how I got involved, why I think it matters, why the perception of crop circles is for the most part not accurate either from the crop circle researchers or obviously from the media. So I'm going to give you another point of view that you probably haven't seen before. This is the presentation that I give to my crop circle tours because since going there in 1997, I've been giving tours. I didn't go this year. This is the first year since 2002. I haven't been over to the UK, but I got so fascinated by the topic, I kept going over and gave tours there. This is the presentation I sort of give them to kind of bring it all together because we do RV practice during the tour. It's in Wiltshire, based in Marlborough, about 2 hours, about an hour and a half west of Heathrow, London area. And I'm going to give you the presentation I give to them to see if we can make sense of some of these different phenomena. And, as scientists, we're often interested in finding, deeper principles that can explain all these phenomena rather than inventing ad hoc theories as you go along. It's kind of more satisfying, I think, if you can find something simple that explains all of it, but completely and comprehensively. So that's what I'm going to attempt to do here in the best of my ability. And we'll have time for questions at the end. So whatever you're curious about, there's plenty of questions about this topic and you're free to interact in about an hour. Okay, so let me show my screen and we will get going here. Here we go. Oops, not that one. All All right. Slideshow. Okay. All right. So, this is how it began for me. If you can see my screen correctly, is it looking okay over there? Yeah.
I think so.
Okay, good. Well, this was my first, this is my phase four session of the first target I did of a crop circle. Courtney had given us this target. This might have been towards the end of the class. And what this was, you know, Courtney studied with Ed Dame, so he used this kind of CRV type matrix. This was his adaptation of Ed Dame's system, right? So this is kind of a modified Ingo Swann protocol. This is what I originally learned. And, you know, I got a lot of strange things during this target. I had good target contact with, you know, the Eiffel Tower and Mount Kilimanjaro and Cancun, Mexico, and all the typical calibration targets that we often do in a beginning RV class. And then Courtney began to give us the so-called more of these esoteric targets where you really didn't have quite the same feedback. You know, things like UFOs, face on Mars, Pleiadian civilizations, and all sorts of interesting things. And I think those are interesting targets to do too, because it's very different than the typical 3D Earth target that we're used to. And it's just a different sort of information. Even if you don't get feedback, the thing is, can you even describe what you're getting? Can you find the right words? Well, in this case, this target did have feedback. It was a crop circle in England from the year before. And let's see, I'll show you a picture of it in a second. It was a three-sided spiral. And I got a lot of stuff related to information and some sort of global themes and UFOs, things related to extraterrestrials. And I really didn't know what this meant. So one of the ideas that I like to present here, I think it's important to keep in mind when you're looking at this topic, is our minds like to condense things, put them in boxes that we already understand, right? We all do this. But there's a concept from Leonardo da Vinci, which I found very helpful, sfumato, which is going into the mist, literally translated from Italian. And it basically translates into our language as confusion endurance, which means to deal with a topic like crop circles, you need to be able to endure a lot of confusion because there's no easy answers to exactly what's going on there. And I think most of the people that have come to conclusions about what crop circles are, what they represent, they are not willing to put up with that confusion. Now, you're all familiar with that type of confusion endurance, right? Because during every RV session, that's what we get, right? A lot of sfumato. We don't really know what we're getting until we get our feedback. And often when we're very confident, we're off target. When we're less confident, we're more on target. And so this sfumato idea has a lot to do with both of these topics. And we're dealing with energy here with crop circles. And I'll show you why in a moment. Lots of sacred geometry shapes, spirals, and phi ratios. If you've seen crop circles before, you're familiar that they have a lot of shapes that are familiar in mathematics, and we see them in nature too. So they're not completely different. They're new, but they have a lot of patterns that we've seen in more conventional shapes, lots of spirals and so forth. Golden mean section often appears in crop circles, and these often appear in different shapes in nature, and our inner ear and our heart have these same sort of shapes. So there's kind of a connection there to resonance right away. This was the first target that this is my first crop circle remotely, right? This is the so-called Windmill Hill. These are all named after the hills and the downs. In the UK, the downs are the hills. So what's down is up over there and vice versa. So the downs are the hills. This is Windmill Hill, triple Julia set from 1996. This was my first crop circle. And after seeing this and saying, well, what in the world is this? I decided I had to find out more about what crop circles are and what they represent, because no one at Farsight really seemed to know very much. There was just this feeling that nobody knew who made them, what they meant or what they represented, but they seem to have been showing up in England since, oh, well, actually, they go way back to probably 100 years, but not very frequently. They had been more frequently seen since the 80s, and in the 90s, they became more complex, like this. They got bigger, they got more complex, they got better looking in some senses. And no one had ever been caught making these. There was really no explanation of what these were, apart from perhaps channeled information or ideas that people had. And in my P3 drawing, this is what I got for this particular target. Remember, it was a blind target. It wasn't double blind. Our monitor at the time, Dale Stevens, who was a friend of Courtney's, had the target in the room. But nonetheless, this is what I got, a circle with a lot of energy going in and out. Those arrows were my kind of representations of energy, and you could see there are beings around or people or something. It looked kind of like target contact to me, you know, a circle with hills in the background or something like that, people around. And this was actually the first one I really did encounter in person. This was the Koch Snowflake by Milk Hill. I'll show you a picture of that later. It's a big, the largest man-made earth mound in Europe. It's about 5,000 years old. Silbury Hill. And this showed up right near Silbury Hill. You can see the scope and size of these folks. If you look, this is about 300 feet across. You can see those little dots in there are people. And this made quite an impression on me. I mean, I had studied this shape in graduate school. It was in a book about fractal geometry. And to save ink, they had not printed the entire Koch snowflake, as it's called, because it was just a lot of black ink. And it said, you know, this space not printed to save ink. So when I encountered this in an actual field 300 feet across, you know, it's quite something else. Just it has a feeling. And you can see there's this kind of geometry to it, an internal lay pattern from, we'll see more of this in the upcoming circles in a moment. But even within the circles, the lay pattern of the wheat, the way the wheat is laid down, has a directionality and a pattern to it. Now, originally, crop circles looked like this, the so-called Tully saucer nests from Australia. These were areas where flying discs were seen. And as they left, people would go to the site where they were in Tully, and they found these patterns in the marsh grasses that looked as if something had either heated the grass or landed on it. So there is a connection to UFOs, no doubt about it, flying discs, whatever they may be. And these are two pictures from the Tully saucer nests, I believe, from the early 1970s, where the discs were seen and these patterns were seen in the marsh later on that resemble a grass circle, right? Those are the three pictures of the Tully saucer nests. So the original circles tend to look like this. They just tend to look like simple circles, small, simple circles, swirled. Okay, swirled simple circles. And the original phenomena resembled, with some exceptions, there's a book you can get called The Secret History of Crop Circles. And I think it's Terry, but it goes into all of the early ones going back 100 years. They generally look like this, but some of them are slightly more complicated. Now, I did talk to a woman, Louise, in northern Idaho about 2 years ago, and she actually saw something like this. She was a friend of the someone who was the MUFON director for Idaho, and then this person, Jan, told me about Louise. Louise had an experience picking huckleberries in Usk, Washington, 1970s, and she did see a flying disc over the huckleberries with a couple other people. She was picking huckleberries with her brother. I'm just telling you this because there is a flying saucer UFO connection to the phenomena. I mean, historically, it is true. She saw this disc. It goes down into, takes off. She hears the sound like wind, and it flattens all the grass. Didn't make a crop circle. It just literally flattened all the grass in the meadow for about 100 yards as it took off in a direction of a lake. And people in the area panicked and called the police, who called the military, and the military sealed the area off for a week after that. She attempted to go up to pick more huckleberries, because that's what her brother did for a living, was make huckleberry types of products, and they couldn't even get back in there a week later. The whole area had been sealed off. So there is a connection to flying discs flattening grass and so forth. It's not a complete fantasy. There is evidence for this, and this is just a person that I know that no one else has ever talked to who had a similar type of experience right here in the United States. So people have this idea that perhaps flying saucers, UFOs, made lots of these crop circles, and because no one had ever been seen doing it, this seemed like, well, maybe they're doing this at night, and people would wait at night on the hills and the downs around England, especially in Wiltshire. We're talking an area, if you look on a map, you can see south of Swindon, north of around north of Stonehenge, in that area is where most of these circles have been appearing. So it's in an area called Wessex, Wiltshire, and that's where these are. And so people would hang out at night. I had done this many times too in the early days, thinking maybe I'd see something making a circle. Here is one of those simple circles that we saw up in Westbury. It was just another... this is an area where the Druids had lived in Wiltshire, and not far from Salisbury here. And you can see, if you can look at the lower part of your screen, that it looked like the original phenomena again. It doesn't look very complex. You can see these patterns in the wheat. It looks like, you know, it was air blasted or something. But this is what the original phenomena looked like going back many decades, kind of simple groups of circles, and kind of like there's a lay pattern, and this looks kind of like it was blasted from above or something. Very curious, right? And we saw one of these just in 2010, just up from, well, they have these beautiful chalk horses that the Celts put in a long time ago, you know, 1,000 years ago, 2,000 years ago, actually. And these have been maintained, and we're looking at this white horse that's made out of chalk, and we saw this pattern there. So this is what they used to look like. You can kind of see that on your screen here. And then there are these strange light anomalies that have been seen. This is one taken by crop circle researcher Colin Andrews, who you may have heard him or seen him give a presentation at various conferences, and he's been studying this for quite a while. And you can see that there's this kind of whirlwind pattern in the wheat. Again, this is kind of like the original phenomena. And then the strange light anomalies that appear around these phenomena. Here's a photo that Colin took of one of them. No one knows what they are. I mean, they're like ball lightning, but they're coherent, you know, seemingly coherent objects that seem to be able to move. They move around. So they appear to be like objects. They are associated with crop circles. Now, this is what the original phenomena, again, looked like back in the 80s. We call it the original phenomena just because this is what it looked like before it got complex, right? Just simple circles, okay? They got more complex in the late 80s. They became more stylized, like these so-called pictograms. Then they became concentric circles. But you can see they're getting more precise looking as we go along here. They're more... precisely formed and more geometric. Here's this famous one from 94, the Mandelbrot set, which I'm sure some of you have seen before. This appeared near, was it Oxford University? Yeah. And people said, there's no way to do this. It's very complex. And how do you get that shape in there? But this is one of the early mysterious ones. And here's a Barbary Castle from, I believe, 91. This was the first real biggie. Huge, you know. Those tram lines, by the way, are 80 feet across or so. This is how they put on the pesticides and chemicals and fertilizers in England. The farms are not big enough to fly like they do here with crop duster planes, so they use tractors, as they call them. They're trams. Those are tram lines, and they're quite far apart, so that gives you a sense of the scale. This showed up near Barbary Castle. It's another hill, old ancient Celtic hill fort. And this one, I mean, this was just the first real huge one, right? This kind of blew people away. This made people think the aliens had really landed, you know. Okay, quite different from the original phenomena here. Now, if you look at this, this shows you, I hope you can see on your screen here, that the lay pattern, there's a swirl. You can kind of see a spiraling from the center out with the wheat. These are mostly in wheat, by the way. Here's a picture of what some people think might have been a crop circle from the 1660s, I believe. They called it the mowing devil. It was a pattern seen in wheat. Some lights were seen in a field, and people thought it must have been the devil come out and make patterns in the wheat overnight. It kind of looks something like a, you know, perhaps a crop circle. But that, in that case, the crop was cut. And what we're talking about here is crop that is not cut. It's just flattened, okay? So there's a difference. So they got more complicated and more complicated. I'm sure many of you have seen these. More, even more complicated and more geometrical and precise and better looking as the years went on, right? Even some of them don't even look like crop circles anymore, right? They look like three-dimensional shapes, almost like three-dimensional art. Now, this was an interesting one. This is from 98. People give names to these formations. They called this the Hydra Formation. It was in a place called West Woods near where we stay in Marlborough. And by the way, the Marlborough is where Marlborough comes from, you can imagine. Borough means borough, and Marl is from Merlin, so Merlin's borough became our Marlborough cigarette, right? But so this is near Marlborough, and this is interesting. This formation affected my camera. It rewound its film. I began to see in 97, 98, some weird effects of these circles without knowing the origin of the circles. I could see effects on my cameras. We'd go into them like this one. The camera stopped focusing and then it rewound its film. This is in film days when you actually had film in your camera, 98. And normally if you had one of those cameras, you're aware that you have to push the button to get it to rewind, but this just rewound on its own twice. It did it at another circle. So I had some evidence of anomalies. There's another formation, which I think I have a picture of a bit down the road here, where Ron Russell, who's the person who introduced me to these circles personally, he gave tours, and I met him at a UFO conference in Denver in 90. It was at the end of 96. Having been at Farsight Institute, talking to a lot of people there who began to tell me about the reality of the UFO subject, I decided, well, I better find out about this. There was a UFO conference in Denver area, and shortly after I had been taking my RV classes, I met a guy there named Ron Russell, who some of you may know have heard of, and Ron gave a talk about crop circles. I thought I would figure out what these were, go to his lecture, and I'd go back to Farsight and tell everyone what these were. Ron said the same thing. We didn't know who was making them, what they meant, and so forth. But when I went with Ron on his crop circle tour the next year, I saw him put a video camera down in the center of a circle by Danebury, and it melted the inside of the camera. He had to send it back to Sony, and they had to resolder it for a couple $100 at the power supply. So he had it on and just set it down, and it melted, stopped working. That was the first of many. I'll show you some videos in a moment of that actually happening to people. So I'm just showing you different ones here. They get more complex. It's from 2000. Now, this was the first indication where we saw a connection to humans. This is a page of a book, Moray and Tessellated Patterns, How to Create Them by John Wilson. Somebody had this sent to them in the mail, a researcher. And we noticed that all five of these patterns had showed up that summer in 2000. And so we thought maybe the aliens were reading our books and making these patterns. You can see this previous one here. Huge, quite big. Was the one at the bottom. So here was some connection to patterns and a book, which was a little weird. Like, how would that be if it wasn't being made by people? Okay. So we started studying this with a static meter. It's a laboratory grade meter made by the Trek company to measure static electricity. We wanted to see maybe if we could tell the difference between the real ones and the fake ones, as we thought at the time, the man-made ones, right? And we thought maybe we'd find a difference in the voltage of static. And we did find initially in the ones where we couldn't tell what had made them, the static charge was higher. And in some of the ones that we knew were man-made that were made experimentally, where the farmer had been paid, the voltage was lower. So we thought maybe we had a litmus test, right? We even made a video about it. We thought there's this litmus test for telling the difference between the so-called real ones and the fake ones, right? You got it. Now, this particular one, didn't know the origin of this one. This is a picture by Colin Andrews. I mean, this is a great picture, isn't it? Just a beautiful formation, 99 Hackpen Hill. This one blew out the static meter. The battery was totally shot when Ron went into it. So here's another instance of battery failure. And just great spiral patterns. So this is based around phi ratios. Quite complex if you look at it. But if you want to see more of this, it's 99 Hackpen Hill. This one that looked like a molecule, it was actually across from the B&B I was staying at. I could see it from the window of my room, believe it or not. Also blew out the static meter when Ron went into it. It was before I had gotten there that summer in 99. Now, just for a little humor here, there are other types of sand circles. Some are made by hermit crabs, right? And you can see this pattern in sand. And I've been recently reading about the circles in Namibia. You've seen those in the desert, that these tiny little circles that appear, but they go on for kilometers, and they're kind of mysterious. Some people thought maybe they were made by termites or something, or patterns of moisture or something like that. So there are different types of circles. I'll show you some sand circles at the end. This is definitely different than your average crop circle, right? If you blur your eyes a little bit, you can see that this is a picture of a woman's face. This was actually an advertisement for Orange phone, and it's definitely not a crop circle. And we're talking about crop formations. When we saw certain of this, we talked about that was just like a human joke. The other ones were real, but this one is obviously, you know, it doesn't look like the aliens made this one. Here was the alien disc. And I hope you're just having some fun with this. You have to go imagine that we're researchers, we're back there not knowing what's going on here, and these are showing up. People would say maybe the aliens are sending us a message. You could see this is an alien. People later found out it had been in a Star Trek from the TV series way back, and there was this disc and the message. It was binary code. It was decoded and so forth. I forget what the message meant. But, you know, it's made up of a certain pattern. It's actually the way print is printed in newspaper with these kind of lines. There's different methods of printing. This is one of them that's used in print. On paper, if you look at it very closely. So very good job. I mean, whoever thinks of these, because it looks great from a distance. This is a so-called face at Chilbolton. People thought, you know, this was near a radio telescope, and people thought, wow, you know, what are the aliens trying to tell us? And then there was the so-called Arecibo response message. You remember this one? Also near the Arecibo, the Chilbolton radio telescope. This was the message, a replica. This is similar to the message that was sent from the Arecibo antenna in Puerto Rico in 74, part of the SETI program, you may remember. And this showed up there. People thought maybe this is the response message because it had similar things but different slight changes to the Arecibo message. So these showed up in 2001 by this radio telescope. And again, very different sort of patterns. So typical crop circles look like this when you go in them. They have a directionality and a lay pattern to the downed wheat. The wheat that's flattened is not just flattened helter-skelter. That's why it looks good from the air, by the way. It's directional. It follows a large-scale order of what sometimes is called in material sciences anisotropy. It has a directionality to it. And you can see this in a very pronounced way from some crop circles that where a lot of attention has been paid to that lay pattern, and they look really good from the air. Some of them don't have that. They're made in different crops. This is in canola. But some of them have it in a quite pronounced way. And people love to walk around these. This is one from a couple of years ago. You can see how much fun folks. People are really drawn to these. And when you go over there, it's just fun to walk around them and kind of explore them. They're like a little maze or a labyrinth or something like this. And some of them, again, quite complex. The more recent ones are super complex. And so these are ones where people would say, there's no way people could do this because it's too complex. It's in the dark, right? It just shows up in the morning. People go out, there it is. Architectural firms had said it would take them 4 or 5 days in the daytime to make something like this, and these just appear overnight. But if we go back in history, people have experimented with patterns before. These are the Giri tiles from Iran and Turkey. kind of tessellated patterns that people have been playing around with for quite a while. And these go back to the Middle Ages. This one's, you know, the 1400s. Tessellated patterns that were done by people without any mathematics training. These were just done, were told, by artists who just were designing them for their beauty. But you see they have some, the shapes have a lot of similarity to crop circle shapes. Again, it wasn't done by trained mathematicians or anyone with computer-assisted design or anything like that. This is just artists kind of winging it, who were just really good at what they did and were capable of creating these types of patterns on their own. Now, this was my first experience with man-made circles. There was this team of circle makers led by Matthew Williams, and they had paid a farmer, someone had paid them to create an ad for the internet, so they asked me to come along with my static meter to see if there was a difference in the static charge before they made the circle in the field as it looks and after they made the pattern. And this was the pattern ahead of time. It was an R in an at symbol. And I got to watch them make this. Again, this is in the daytime. It's a small circle paid advertisement that they had been commissioned to do. And I got to see how people made crop circles. And I got to measure the energy with the static meter before and after. And it was quite interesting to see this. Kind of a shock. It was a small circle like this. So not the biggest thing. And people would look at this and say, that doesn't look like the huge ones, right? But it's decent enough looking. Here's one that was made by Matthew Williams. People had said there's no way humans could make a seven-sided circle. And Matt did this by himself, I believe. And he got arrested for it because he had sent us the pattern ahead of time and to a couple other people. And they sent this into some other people, not us, obviously, sent it into the police. And the police arrested him, not because he was caught. So someone was arrested for this back in 2000, and the judge fined him £150, which is like $225 of our dollars. So don't, you know, ask the farmer before you do this. But this showed that people could make complex patterns. This is the pattern that Matt sent to me ahead of time, you know, that to prove that this would show up within a couple days in a field, right? Seven-sided, kind of challenging. Sometimes farmers put up donation boxes to collect from the damages when people walk in it. You know, they call them corn over there. We call it wheat. This was actually a fake box that someone put up. After years of putting up collection boxes, someone said, maybe I'll put up a box and people will just put money in it and I'll take it. And that's what this one. This was not the real thing. Someone on my tour group had seen that this fake box was going around. When we went into the circle, he said, Sim, that's the fake box. So we took it and gave it to the farmer down the road who should have collected the money from it. Here's one by Stonehenge from 96, and the farmer collected about £40,000 from tourists who got to walk in this. You know, it's $60,000 just from saying you can go in, but pay us, you know, a couple dollars first. Balls of light have been associated with the phenomena. It's assumed maybe they made them, right? When we didn't see who was doing it. Here is one. Now, we were doing a meditation out there on Woodboro Hill. This is very near the Salisbury Plain, which is their military operating area, and Area 51 combined into one, since it's not a big country over there. So this is where we were with Stephen Greer doing a skywatch. And this ball of light was seen in front of the hill, taken by a German tourist who was on his way to meet us. And he just thought he'd stop and take a picture of the hill. And you can see there is a ball of light there. So these have been seen around there. It's right over a crop circle. These have been seen around crop circles, believe it or not. Whether they make them or not, I mean, that's a whole different discussion. But people have photographed these. You can see this one towards the upper part of the screen. Looking at their film later and not intentionally going out to film anything, they just look at the film. There's something moving across that doesn't look like a bird or anything we can identify. This was from an actual video frame by Barbary Castle, I think, 99. So these are associated with the circles, too. There was one by this one, Fosbury. It's by another Hillford. I just happened to be doing a Qigong standing meditation, and somebody photographed a ball of light going across us. Alleged ball of light. I mean, we don't actually know what this is, and maybe if you looked at it closer, it could be something else. But you know, there you have some evidence of some these kind of. This is you've heard of these balls of light. They are associated with the formations in some way. And strange light phenomena. This was taken by a Japanese tourist. You can see, even if that is like dust or you know pollen, it seems to be formed like a DNA spiral type shape right in the center of the crop circle. This is kind of strange looking, you know. Here is a picture of me in the lower left walking down Devizes, which is another town in the area there of Wiltshire. And you could see this kind of strange electrical energy interacting with that steeple on top of the church there. It's just, we don't know again what, you know, what that is, but it's an example of strange energies in the area of crop circles that are real. Here's just someone that photographed one of them. You know, there wasn't a storm at the moment, but, you know, it's some sort of electrical discharge. So here was the first one that I got to see at Done at Night. This was at Cherhill in 2000. A group asked me, would you like to see us make a complex one? They had begun to trust me because they really saw me as someone that was open to evidence. And even though I didn't believe humans could make them back then, honestly, I didn't. They said, well, why don't you, you know, you saw a small one made at the R formation that I showed you. This is a bigger one. And they did it at night. They gave me that pattern about an hour beforehand, and they went out there and they used these boards and they pushed down the rope, and it was quite good. I mean, they had some beginners there. It's not the best looking one ever, but they showed me they could make a complex one. It took about 5 hours. People came the next day. I went back, and people were enjoying it just like any other circle. So that's when I realized maybe these were all in the recent ones, maybe they're all man-made this way. I mean, it's kind of a shock going. I used to get up on stage, folks, and say that these could not be made by people, and I was wrong. Okay, so it's good to admit that you could be wrong. I was wrong. They are made by people. The recent ones, we may have started making our own. We paid farmers, and we would rent their field, and they would let us make circles in their field. We did this to see if we could do it. And this is someone, Peter Sorensen, who had made many circles before, and he showed us how to do it. We had these boards made and everything, and it was a lot of fun making these, pushing the wheat down, and we wanted to measure the static charges. We would find slight changes in static once the formation was there. This is Masao Maki, who's a circle researcher from Japan, also has a sushi restaurant in the United States here in Boulder. So this is what our formations looked like there. You know, not really sophisticated, but we weren't very sophisticated either. It looked like a similar one a couple days later. We thought maybe the aliens are imitating us, but whatever. Here are some that appeared. This one was very mysterious. This the one in the bottom had been commissioned by the BBC, you know, the BBC TV over there. But the one at the top was, no one knew who made that. People said, well, that's the real one. You know, that's the alien one. But it turned out to be the logo of Masao Maki's sushi restaurant, okay? It's his family crest of his family from Japan. And he had just done it to show, when he realized people were making them, he wrote a book for Japanese audience to show that they could be made this way. So we have many good examples of human-made ones, and we've made them here in the U.S. too, just to experiment. And a typical grass looks like this. It's just disorganized. It may have a slight pattern to it, but this is not a crop circle. This is just photos of kind of haphazard grass. But, you know, the wheat looks like this in a crop circle, very directional and very ordered. And here's another one we made, by the way. This is the Math Matrix. We got commissioned to do this in 2006 by Scott Flansburgh. He wanted to make a matrix of numbers because he's in the Guinness Book of World Records to be able to add numbers in his mind better than anyone else on the planet, based around a base 9 number system rather than base 10 like we use most of the time. So we made one for him. It was commissioned. It looked quite good. You know, we had a very good artist make the numbers just by hand in there, just walking around to make those numbers. Took a couple days, and it did seem to affect a video camera. Now, I just wanted to show you something interesting about this. we put a sign up saying that this had been made by us. We call ourselves Team Cosmos for Scott Flansburgh. And people wrote, someone wrote across the sign, you know, liar. They just didn't believe that we could have made it, you know, because it looked too good in some parts. And so we were there and people would say to us, can you explain this and can you explain that? And we couldn't explain all of it, but we did make it. So you, part of this, you know, my background, folks, is as a sociologist. It's very interesting to see what beliefs do you have about reality and why do you have them, you know? Because often you may believe things that are contradicted by the data and you hold on to your beliefs. We all do this because we like to be right. And in this case, there are people who can't believe humans can make them. And even if you say we were paid, we're here and we have a sign, they won't believe you. So people who consider themselves open-minded, it becomes kind of like a religion and a bit frightening. So here's some, I'm going to show you examples of the energy effects of these circles. It gets stranger from here on in. This is one at so-called Devil's Den, Fifield Down. We were one of the first people to go into this circle, and it affected lots of batteries. It affected Masamaki's video camera as he went in. It stopped working. It affected my static meter, and it affected the batteries on these the GPS device. Hello?
Ben, hold on.
Yeah.
I'm going to mute everybody.
Silence your phones, please.
I'll turn you on again.
Unmuted.
Okay.
Okay. Are we good?
To take care of the noise. Then.
Yeah, no problem. Okay, so we've had a lot of battery failure. I will show you some videos right at the end of this of this battery failure, but this is three devices failing in about 10 minutes. This person had 14 hours of battery life when they came in. Okay. And go on. So we have seen this. This is by Danbury Hillford. I told you this is the one where Ron's camcorder melted in the middle of this formation back in 97. Martin Cell Hill, 2009. We're with Colin Andrews. Oh, this one is funny because you see it's not quite perfect. So people thought maybe the aliens kind of, the beams didn't go down right. So maybe they something went wrong with the sat-nav system. But we Colin Andrews, we had his camera go bad there. He's a longtime researcher. Just stop working. So I've seen this many times, perhaps about 15 to 20 times in about 5% of the circles we've gone into. Your camera will stop working. Sometimes it will burn out. I'll show you the videos of these at the end, by the way, just as a little easier. It's happened at these different formations. This is a watch. Now, this was really weird. We had an electrical engineer with us, and this had a compass in it. What this fellow noticed as he was in this formation is that north and south were no longer 180 degrees apart. They were 90 degrees apart. Weird. It something about being in the circle bent the magnetic field. In this formation up at Westwoods, 2008, I had my camera lose its ability to focus. And we were around this formation. We had some other anomalies happen. This is when I was National Geographic made a video about this and they were filming me talking about this, but they didn't show much footage of it at the end. But we were down here and some laptops stopped working. That's, by the way, Silbury Hill. That's the largest earth mound in Europe. Right behind there. It's an ancient place. So let's, here are some more man-made ones that look pretty good. This was done for a movie that never made it here to the States. This one was done for Japanese television. You know, just a couple hours. They had some hours left at night. You can see the tower set up for the Japanese TV crew to take there. Film footage. It was done without light, and they made it two in one night. Okay. Let's see. Sometimes there's strange materials found in them, and bent. Okay, so this is the thing: the bent stalks, bent nodes. People have said that this is a sign of authenticity. We have found this. This is one we made again a couple of years ago. You know, we pay the farmer, and go in and make something. And we found these bent nodes in our own formations. So perhaps it's not something that's the cause of the formation appearing. It's an effect. Once the formation is there, the plants are exposed to the sun differently, or there's an energy there and it affects them. You get these enlarged nodes even in man-made formations. Now, this is interesting. Colin Andrews, who I showed you a photo of before, measured this particular formation at Milton Hill Farms, 2000, with a magnetometer. He worked with an engineer from France, and they used a very large magnetometer that you have to drag across the dirt, and they got these magnetic patterns where the formation was. Now, they didn't know what we knew, that this was man-made, because we got to know the people who had made it just kind of synchronistically, walking around this village and other things. We pieced it together. We got to know all five people who made this formation. They didn't put any magnets there, but there's magnetic patterns superimposed on the crop formation. So there is some interaction between the crop formation and our electromagnetic fields in ways that are not completely explainable, man-made ones. So I think you're getting the picture here, is that the man-made ones are real in the sense that they create electromagnetic disturbances that are measured by magnetometers, by our cameras and batteries and so forth. Colin thought maybe there were magnets buried here, but there were not. As far as we know, no one, the circle makers didn't put any magnets. They'd have to be very big magnets to create a source like that. Colin said they'd have to be huge, and they're not there. So here we have a crop circle creating electromagnetic disturbances in a kind of a iso morphic way to the actual electromagnetic pattern. It's just very similar looking. Okay. Here's one that we made in Kansas. We made this coming back from the 2002 Austin RV conference. Remember that one, Irva? Where Ingo spoke to us and all that, right? About the 20 senses that we all have. We had permission to make a small one on the way back, and even this one had very large static readings. Now, there was a big storm coming in, but it affected the film. And Ron, this is a film camera that had never done this before, and all the pictures of this circle that we took of ourselves, it took only 15 minutes to make, had very strange images on the film, which don't, are not easy to explain. Just there's weird light energies. Look at this one. It just looks very weird. Like there's some sort of energy present on the film. But this one is man-made. What is this? I mean, this is the same circle. This is a picture of the crop circle, but this doesn't look like the crop circle, does it? So here's another example of circles affecting film camera. Here's an anomaly where this is Ron Russell holding up the static meter, but it's obviously the film pigments there. So what's the explanation for this? I'm not entirely sure, but I believe that they act like liquid crystals. I used to build these crystal radios as a kid. Crystal radios generate their own electricity just from the pattern of the crystal. And liquid crystals are in all of our devices nowadays. And liquid crystals, when you put energy into them, they either move, or vice versa. When you move liquid crystals, they generate electricity. So perhaps the alignment of the grains of the wheat, the stalks of the wheat in these very coherent patterns, turns the circle into kind of like a waveguide as a crystalline effect of the wheat in some way, perhaps the chlorophyll or something like this. This one actually is not a crop circle. This is made of CDs that someone had placed. But look how kind of cool it represents a crop circle. It looks like a crop circle from up in the air, but it's just these CDs tied together. And so the pattern here, by the way, that shape later showed up in Science Magazine that year as it's a type of liquid crystal, those seven together. Liquid crystals move around, they have different patterns, but the kind of coherency that you find in a crop circle is seen in liquid crystals. So there's a lot of similarity. This looks like the wheat, but it's just a liquid crystal. There's a lot of similarities there. And if you know anything about liquid crystals, we don't have to get into this too much in depth. They can create static charges, electromagnetic charges. They can act like metamaterials. They can actually bend light. They can create invisibility with a so-called reverse negative refraction index. This is something I've studied a lot since trying to find out an explanation of why you get all this camera and battery failure. Is perhaps they can create magnetic changes, liquid crystals, the vorticity, the so-called spiral shapes. can create magnetic changes. And this is something that Marty could probably knows a lot more about than I do. But this theme of coherent spiral shapes in an active material is a theme that we see a lot in material sciences. And material scientists are working a lot right now at a quantum level and at a so-called mesoscopic level between the micro and the macro world where we inhabit and the subatomic level to create these kind of custom-made metamaterial, tunable metamaterials shapes to generate energy and various effects at all different levels in the electromagnetic spectrum. And maybe this explains, a metamaterial can bend light. And maybe this explains, it looks, a lot of the baseline of photonic crystals, by the way, are look like these grid patterns. That's exactly what we've seen in the field before the crop circle is made. The tram plants the seeds in these long lines. And perhaps this has something to do with what we're seeing in the crop circles with the light anomalies, camera failure, battery failure. What makes a photonic crystal do what it does is the defects. If it's too perfect, it doesn't act like a waveguide. There has to be a defect in this so-called log pile to get a result. It's a very interesting theme in superconductivity and in a whole range of cold fusion and other areas that it's the defects that create the anomalous effects, not the perfection. And in the field, the defect is the crop circle. It's a very good looking defect. But it's from the point of view of a evenly planted field, a crop circle is a defect. And that's what makes these photonic crystals bend light, move light, create invisibility, create magnetic changes. They even look a lot like crop circles, don't they? These metamaterials. So light is bent and moved. And, I've struggled to exactly think how that could happen in a circle. It's something I'm puzzling through. But we know that the chlorophyll and the ability of photosynthesis in the plant to change light into energy, there's already some processes working there at an nanometer scale. And perhaps the rearrangement of the crop in these very coherent patterns organizes the photosynthesis and the chlorophyll in a way that it's not used to, and it has sort of waveguide effects. But basically, the wheat is kind of like a liquid. I mean, it's not really solid. It is, but it can be moved around, which is like liquid, which makes it very much like a liquid crystal. Liquid crystals also create correlated changes in electricity, which is related to Cooper pairs and superconductivity, which is materials that conduct electricity much more effectively and efficiently than our typical metals that we're used to in our electrical and electronic systems. If you can get this at room temperature, you'd have devices, as Marty can probably elaborate, that would be much more efficient and need much less energy. They'd go for much longer without batteries needing to be recharged and so forth. And perhaps there's a type of superconductivity happening. I mean, there's other types of latticework structures like graphene where you see this room temperature superconductivity. So that's another possibility that there's some superconductivity happening. I've wondered whether the circles are interacting with dark energy in some way. There are this dark matter, which we've learned about since, I believe it's the 30s or 40s, that people saw there's other matter in the universe that you can't see that holds galaxies together, so-called dark matter. And it looks like this if you could see it. It looks like filaments going across the universe. There's also dark energy, which was discovered in the 90s, which is the force that pushes galaxies apart. And I was reading an article about dark energy once, and it said if it was a field, a weak field, but nonetheless something that interacted with Earth, you would see it as anomalous static charges that could damage batteries. So I thought, click, maybe the crop circle is acting like an antenna, a waveguide for dark energy. I mean, it's just a possibility, but that would explain why you get the battery failure there, right? So the bottom line is there's still so much we don't know about our own universe, and it pertains to our Earth right here. There are things we don't know, and I would argue to you that the crop circles are something that we can't really explain very easily. Even if they're made by people, and we've made our share now, I've made bunches of them, and it's a lot of fun. I recommend it if you ever want to experiment. But why do we get the strange effects? And I will show you the videos in a second before we go to questions about the batteries failing. It just happens over and over again. So in my view, to sum this up, the man-made circles are real. They're real because even if they weren't created in a sense by extraterrestrials or vortexes of plasma energy or lightning or whatever, even if people are making them, like you see them making this sand circle, the effects are real. And perhaps it was at one point an extraterrestrial phenomena in the past, but it somehow inspired humans to improve on those shapes. It got people curious and they made them better and better, so to speak. And it creates a type of resonance. And that resonance creates effects that we can see in the electromagnetic area that affects our equipment and so forth, and creates a lot of strangeness, a lot of weird effects, anomalous effects that are very similar to superconductivity and other effects. So RV, remote viewing, can be kind of a type of seen as an unstructured resonance that you create on the page just from your following the signal line, your unconscious, your imagination, however that works. This is a type of structured resonance where the pattern is already laid out. It's like a very structured ideogram. That's how I look at these circles. You can make them in sand too. These are pictures taken from a kite, by the way. If you go online, they're taking these pictures now with drones of these sand circles. These are done in Breen on the coast of the UK, the West Coast. Obviously, you can tell they're made by people who know how to make crop circles too, but these are legal at least, because it's not legal to go out in a farmer's field and just make a pattern like this. But these look pretty good. I haven't been out to these to test or to see if any of the strange effects happen. But if what I'm saying is true, you should be able to create the effects of the crop circles in other materials. And again, it shows us that we don't totally, there's another pathway of communications and interaction of our own regular everyday universe that we don't understand very well. But that if you create these coherent patterns, these lattice structures, just like they exist at the subatomic level. I mean, increasingly I'm reading that this ECAT and cold fusion and so-called Lehner low energy nuclear reaction may be due to the lattice structure of the materials that they're using, interacting in ways that quantum mechanics hasn't fully explored yet, that it fits within that scientific tradition, but it wasn't something that people explored because people thought the nucleus, atomic nuclei, were either a gas or a liquid, but perhaps it has a lattice structure. Well, these have structures too, and they also create energy effects. So maybe there's a kind of a commonality there. Pretty cool for sand, don't you think? But it'd be even cooler if we found out that this is a type of advanced technology that these circle-making artists, and these are mostly very talented graphics artists, many of them untrained, but they're good at it. Some of them are trained. There's a group from London that were trained in this quite extensively, but I mean in graphic arts, but they applied it to a new material, wheat, and now they're doing it in sand. And it shows us that there are these patterns there and very strange effects that no one's really investigated very much yet, but it has a lot to do with what we do because you're dealing with energy and information. There are plenty, by the way, just before I show you the videos, of RV type experiences in these circles. One of these circles, Matt Williams, told me once, he was actually in bed and he had this feeling like he should go out and make a certain pattern, a flower of life pattern. He went over to the Avebury area, which is where the stone, huge stone circle is, that's older than Stonehenge and larger, by the way. It encompasses the whole village, Avebury. And he had the feeling to make a flower of life. He made the pattern. He heard some strange sounds, people playing music and so forth. Went home the next day, found out that there was a group right there about 100 yards away from him meditating on a flower of life symbol, hoping that that would show up in that field. Right? Now, what is the odds of that? It's the same odds as like Pear Labs results or something, you know, things that we're familiar with. It's like billions to one. I mean, here he gets this idea to make the circle. They're meditating on the shape. They never talked. He asked them later if they were playing music and nothing. They hadn't, were making a sound. They didn't hear anything. So it's just another kind of, you know, I'll tell you, there are a lot of stories of people being in these circles, bending time lags and strange effects on their watches. They may go into a circle for 20 minutes and their friends said they were gone for 4 hours, things like this. It doesn't fit later with what they saw on their watch. So perhaps there's an effect on space-time too. I mean, people report this. I haven't seen it myself directly, but it's reported, and that's a type of case that Matt was telling us about. But there are a lot of cases, by the way, of people envisioning a certain pattern in their mind only to find that it showed up that night or something. So it does relate to our a kind of an informal type of RV, that you get this information being transferred without an obvious explanation how that can happen. So let me just show you before I summarize here and finish to get to some of your questions. Some of these videos that I've taken of, I have a, if you go to bit.ly/cropcircleweirdness, I put this YouTube playlist together of these weird effects and batteries failing. Let's look at this one first. I was telling you about let's just skip this ad. Hold on a second. This is the Devil's Den formation.
The GPS has just gone wrong, basically, and the screen has gone.
Look at this, the strange sort of pixelation. I think it's
like it's been pushed or something.
This is, that's totally past it. The last time I had this, all my batteries got red hot.
There's the battery.
Yeah, flat as a pancake.
Come on, no.
That's the only second time it's ever happened.
You
thing.
Had 14 hours when you came in.
14 hours of battery life when I came in.
Okay, let's take a look at this one.
Put your camera. And has it ever done that before?
No, I've taken 900 photos on an iPhone.
And what do you think's causing that?
So he said he took 900 pictures and it just, let's take a look at this one. 900 photos and just stopped. Here is my camera losing its ability to focus. And this is the one that showed his watch earlier.
Okay, Dan, can you tell me about what happened with your compass here?
If I have a digital compass in Casio. Without compass anyway. It's lost its calibration after it's on the crop circle. It came back and it's, when I turn 90 degrees, I get a 180 degree reading. No, it shows north over here and south over here, which is 90 degrees to each other.
Something's happened to it.
Has it ever done that before?
No.
Thanks.
Oh, about 50 yards from the cross circle, my camera was working perfectly.
Has it ever done this before?
Never, ever. I think it's shot.
All right. So let me show you one famous video. This is of one of these balls of light. This was taken by Steve Alexander.
And
he was just out on a hilltop, Milk Hill, where a lot of crop circles have shown up, and he took this picture of this ball of light. It appears to, you know, just kind of flickering. He didn't know what it was. This is 1990. This is before drones existed. that, you know, we can fly ourselves. And again, it's another type of, it started in that one formation you saw at the beginning. It left, it went down into the field, then it goes back up and went over to another crop circle. It seems like it has a directional intelligence to it. It passes over a tractor. The tractor driver saw it. He didn't talk about it for 5 months because he didn't want people to make fun of him, but he said it was a luminous, flashing beach ball sized object, and it caused his engine to stall on his tractor. And then after passing over the tractor, it just goes straight up and into a cloud. You can see the you can see it here. It goes down into the wheat and then it comes up again. Now, is this a type of a plasma? Is it a ball lightning? Is it a physical object? The tractor driver said it was a beach ball sized object, and it appears to have an interest in let's move it along here a little bit. Now, this is the interesting thing that happens next. This is the full, this is on YouTube, by the way. You can see this. It's a Milk Hill UFO 1990 unexplained, because we don't know what it is. It seems to affect the camera. We've talked about the camera anomalies here, but look how this is a video camera with film from the old days. It seems to start, the camera appears to lose its color resolution and everything's all green, which may be an effect of the object if it was giving off electromagnetic energy. So you can see it there right in the middle of your screen. Now, I'm just showing this to you because this is the type of thing that has been seen around crop circles. There's the tractor in the back. And it's real. And here's a video of it that, you know, we're certain is the real thing, because we have another witness. We have that tractor driver. And he sees it. You'll see he turns around the tractor. There's another crop circle, by the way, just to the right here that you can't quite see at Milk Hill. There's the video losing resolution. He turns around and then the tractor stops just when the ball of light is over. So again, this is part of a whole nother genre of, you know, UFO related effects, and it's a whole nother field that you may be interested in or not, or have read something about. But here we have an example of something like that around crop circles, and then it just goes straight up in the air. So again, this is something that looks like an intelligently guided object. Perhaps it's physically structured and it's rotating, which is why it's flashing. A little hard to explain what, you know, what that could be, and with the other effects we see here right around crop circles, seems to could be remotely controlled. You can use your imagination. I don't know what this is, but just to show you that some of these effects are definitely there, and you know, we've seen them. People have videotaped them. Obviously, I've shown you. I've seen and videotaped a bunch of them, and I would say, you know, at this point, it's still pretty anomalous. So it just kind of goes up and away it goes. So that's pretty much my presentation for you. And just to sum it up, you know, my feeling is that either from the people who've researched crop circles, they didn't want them to be man-made. Most of them are very set in the idea that it had to be made by balls of light or UFOs, and I've been convinced that the modern ones, at least everything from 1993, has been made by people in the UK. But that didn't resolve these issues of these strange electromagnetic effects, which I've shown you some examples of, and I think it relates to our interest in RV, because it shows that there's other ways of energy and information move around on our world and in our universe that is not explainable by classical physics. And the energy, the coherence of the patterns seems to have something to do with that energy and information transfer. Now, when we write an ideogram on a page, for those of us who do CRV or something like that, there's also a pattern there, but it's something that comes directly out of our, you know, autonomic nervous system. It's an instantaneous reaction to the target that we're describing. In this case, people have ideas for these man-made ones to create the patterns ahead of time. But where do they get the ideas from to create these patterns. If we talk to a lot of these circle makers, they tell us that these patterns show up in their minds and they feel compelled to go out and make them. Okay? It can take them weeks to figure out the geometry. I've been able to get some of the original patterns from them. There was an auction a couple of years ago for a ecological charity, and they sold off a lot of their patterns that they had used to make these, and I had bought a bunch of them just, you know, because they're kind of like historical documents for some of these great patterns that we've enjoyed over the years. But where did those come from? You know, sometimes they just spontaneously show up in their mind. So to me, there's still a lot of mystery to this phenomena. It's not just the battery and camera failure in of itself. It's just that the fact that you and I could go out, we can make a coherent shape, and it's going to have electromagnetic effects. It doesn't fit into anything that physics can explain easily. Batteries don't fail just for no reason. I mean, they will around ionizing radiation, but they, you know, why would they, you just go into this pattern? It has to be that the circle itself is acting like a waveguide. And we're acting like waveguides, you know, in a sense, when we do RV to capture distant information, describe it as accurately as we can on the page. These are acting like waveguides, but they're tuned. We don't know what they're tuned to exactly, but it's almost like I feel like we're dealing with a technology where we don't know what the knobs do and the dials. And we're twisting the knobs and the dials and getting these reactions. Imagine you and I had a computer 100 years ago and we start typing things and we don't know what we're doing, or a radio before radios really existed and we don't know what those knobs are for. This is what these patterns are for. If you look at the shapes, they're seen throughout physics in many different ways at a subatomic scale. But here we have them at a macro scale, and they seem to be having interesting effects. So it just, again, shows us there's a large portion of physics yet to be discovered. I think that, to me, is what the crop circle lesson is. It's probably much more complex than you originally thought, or probably not what you originally thought, which is fine. It's good to grow and learn about new ideas. And there's probably a big portion of how our physical universe interacts with the unseen part that we don't really understand very well, but it exists. It's real. It has tangible effects on us. Just like at Pear Labs, people can influence a random number generator. Shapes and crops can affect devices in ways that haven't been really explored yet, but it's awfully interesting, and it just shows us there's a lot more we don't know than we do know. And that's a fascinating thing to kind of keep in mind in connection to all these different other phenomena. So that pretty much concludes my talk. Any questions? Thanks for listening, by the way, to all this. And is there anything that you'd like to ask or talk about? And don't feel bashful.
Sim, thank you very much for that. That was really just illuminating and very, very interesting. And, of course, raises lots and lots of interesting questions.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead. I think you guys can unmute yourselves. Well, I'm going to unmute you all, and let's just be quiet. And why don't you just jump in and ask a question?
I've got one. This is Nancy. Hi, Sam.
Hey. Hi, Nancy.
Because we love to dance around in the all there is, remote viewing is so, it adds such an element of mystery. When I think of the research, my favorite research is the attention, intention, and expectation that we know is so true with remote viewing. I would think that in the creation of a man-made crop circle, with all of the huge amount of focus that it takes to create something as magnificent on such a big scale, could we, when we are doing this act together of creating a crop circle, or remote viewing, or maybe even both, affect things in such a way that it changes the electrostatic, the electromagnetism, just changes things in ways that we just don't understand, that it might work with crop circles, it might work with other huge, massive works of art that take concentration and focus, that it's a human element that isn't part of our physical beings, but more of our intention and attention and that expectation, that focus, that strong focus that we have in a group. It's powerful.
Yeah. That's a very good comment and question. It has a bunch of different answers at different levels, but I will start out by saying that the circle making groups that I got to know all say incantations and set intentions before they make the circle. I've never been with a group that didn't set an intention before they make the circle, okay? So perhaps that group coherency, just like it mattered at Pear Labs, they found that bonded couples affected the machines more than people by themselves. And I think that's what Joe Gallenberger was telling us to some degree when they do their work, you know, in Las Vegas and stuff with his work of affecting machines with intention. And we've heard this before. The intentionality does seem to make a difference. And I can tell you these circle-making groups, they will actually ask permission from the universe before they make the circle that night. If they don't get a good feeling when they go out there, they won't do it. And there are cases when they went in and they didn't have a good feeling about it, but they went ahead anyway. I know this happened back in 98. They were literally chased out of the fields by balls of light. I'm not making this up. You had young, you know, guys in their 20s with these boards who are normally would not be scared of anything at night, fleeing the fields from balls of light that converged on their position from outside, just showed up and converged on them. At first they thought they were cars, but they floated over the field. And they have seen lots of other strange things out there at night while they're making them. I should mention that, including larger craft and so forth. And smaller sized craft. But the intentionality does seem to matter, according to them. And when I would go out with them, they would say an intention like, it would be something like this: let this crop circle create magic for anyone who sees it or enters it. A positive intention. So I think that does seem to make a difference. And it's possible that our own excitement about it could generate something else. But at a larger level, what your question suggests is that reality leaks. It's not airtight. You know what I mean? It looks solid when we look around, and quantum mechanics tells us it isn't, right? But that's at a subatomic level. But RV and crop circles are two examples where something is happening that shouldn't be from the conventional model of scientists. It's another example why that conventional model doesn't explain our data. And this is just another phenomenon where it doesn't. There's some sort of, it's first of all, you know, going back to your question, it's malleable. It's sort of flexible. It can be changed with our intention and our interaction with it. And then the energy and information seems to leak out from one point in space and time to another in some way under the surface that we can't see. And so to answer your question, it seems that the way we're interacting with it is affecting that, which is just kind of fascinating. You know, just fascinating.
Very fascinating.
We're just at the tip of the iceberg of how we do that. You know, and isn't that what the precog experiments that Marty and other people do all about? Is we're interacting with some way that our scientific upbringing told us is impossible, and yet it's happening. So what is going on there? I mean, I personally believe that science does explain these phenomena, but not our science yet. It's something perhaps a science of the future. You know, something incorporating principles. It doesn't work according to the Newtonian Cartesian model. Let's put it that way. It's more like that book Flatland by Edwin Abbott from the 1890s, where they discovered that there's a higher dimensional reality. Well, one citizen of Flatland discovers that there's a higher dimensional reality when a sphere shows up one day. And it turns out they arrest him and put him away forever. And it turns out that the government of Flatland knew about Sphereland all the time, but they didn't want people to know because they thought it would cause social upheaval. So they preferred it to be a flat land. We live around these institutions, in a sense, that want to keep it flat, and yet we're around these phenomena that tell us that it's not flat. So something's got to give. And this is just another phenomena where I found out that this is true. And again, it shows that we interact with it and we can play with it. Yep.
Very interesting.
Yeah. Thanks for that question. Anybody else? Anything else?
Do you think that the life? Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
Do you think the life of the wheat affects it? Life.
Yeah. A lot of these phenomena I've seen seem to happen when the wheat is fresher and more green. As the summer goes on, the wheat basically dies, and that's when they harvest it at the end in early August. Around this time, they start harvesting it through August. It depends how dry it gets. And as it gets drier, the effects seem to go away. So that might be a little clue about why it does what it does is that it has something to do with the water and patterns in water. And then you're thinking, you know, other phenomena that the water seems to matter, like homeopathy or Dr. Emoto patterns in the water. I remember when Dean Radin said that he sent double-blind samples of water to Dr. Emoto. Some of the water they had meditated on and some they hadn't. And he was skeptical, but Emoto's lab could tell the difference between the samples that they meditated on or not. Again, so water has patterns in it that can be detected. It has something to do with crystals. And we find these patterns, these anomalies, seem to happen more in fresher circles. That Devil's Den formation that I showed you by that dolmen, they called it the Devil's Den because, you know, it was just an old Celtic burial area. That was a very fresh circle. And other people, by the way, came in. I showed you the GPS device failing and my static meter had failed and other devices. But people told me they went in the next day and the next day and they had their devices not work for 6 to 8 months after being in that circle. Batteries wouldn't take a charge. They went home, put it in a drawer. All of a sudden, a year later or half a year later, the battery took a charge again. That was a very fresh circle. So maybe it has something to do with water and the age of the wheat. Eventually, you wonder what happens to those crop circles. They get eaten because they get harvested, and those particular fields are for animal food. So,
interesting.
Yeah.
Hi, Simeon.
Hey.
Hi there. This is Deborah.
Hi, Deborah.
Thank you for a wonderful presentation. It was fantastic. I have to say it's disturbing that so many people are going out and creating these, that it really makes it so unlikely so that we will see a real one. And it seems really analogous to when a magician, you know, shows that they can do what psychics do, and all the attention goes to what they're manufacturing, and then people don't have the time and attention and focus on, you know, the real psychic work that's being done. So how do you reconcile that?
Well, I know, Deborah, I know how you feel, because that is, I felt that way for a long time, and I know a lot of people feel like you do. I just take the other point of view, that if these circle makers hadn't come along and made these more complex ones, we wouldn't have had as many, and they wouldn't have had as varied a shape. These circle makers don't see themselves as hoaxers. Now, there are a few out there that do it that way, but the vast majority, the ones that I've gotten to know, are really highly skilled artists, and they see themselves as creating a magical art. And if you look in the history of art, there are still a lot of artists that used processes they wouldn't show how they were creating their paintings, right? I believe that there was a guy that wrote a book about the camera obscura, about techniques that artists were using to create art without showing that they were using these devices to do it. And so I think it's part of a tradition of secret art. And you have to imagine we're in the UK here, and they're kind of continuing with their tradition. Now, some of us may have seen it as I originally saw it, the way you're talking about, like kind of something that was being faked or hoaxed. But once I got to know them, I realized they see themselves as creating a magical art. Now, if they were very upfront about it, like we were when we made something, paid the farmer and put up a sign, people still didn't believe us anyway. And if they would tell people we made this, people would destroy it. They would be angry a little bit. So I kind of see them as part of the process. And it's kind of normal for humans to experiment and to be creative. And perhaps that is what we're looking at here, is something that was originally created in some cases by flying discs, UFOs, and it was a language. And humans came along to learn to speak that language of shapes. And these people created patterns that you and I wouldn't have been able to do. You're entitled to feel that way. I'm just trying to show you that there's another way to look at it. They started out, by the way, let me say, Deborah, one thing. These guys started out, they're mostly guys. They started out like researchers, like we would be, like hanging out on the downs at night, waiting for a UFO to show up to make it. And they got tired of waiting. So they thought, maybe we'll make a small one and the aliens will answer us. And they started making really small ones, and they said, well, that wasn't too bad. Maybe we can make it this next time. And they just started experimenting. And then they realized that they were the ones making them. They could wait forever and they would not see those complex patterns. So they started out as researchers, littlest tiny patterns, and realized these kind of look okay. And they got a lot of press attention, by the way. Artists, you know, love attention, even if it's anonymous. And the helicopters flying over, and they, even Doug and Dave, the two guys from the pub, they made bunches of them. And here's what they said at the end, Doug and Dave, in their BBC interview. And this is what nobody picked up. The final sentence of the interview, they said, we always felt like something else was making us do it. Okay.
Huh.
So even they feel that there's a mystery to it. And the reason most of them are anonymous is there's a lot of hostility directed at them from the kind of point of view you're sharing a little bit, but much more intense than that, saying this isn't something humans should be involved in. I take the other point of view that we're here to experiment as long as we do it in a, you know, kind of open, ethical way. And for better or worse, they did this. They're not doing as many now, you'll see, but they did this for like 20 years and they felt compelled. Some of them felt compelled to do it. So this is just what happened. And I understand your point of view. There's another way to see it too.
Yeah, that makes sense. And is there a difference in the way that the wheat falls in the man-made ones, or I guess you're saying that there's not really any of the other kind to be sure to compare, but
yeah.
But the anomalies with the wheat that they used to report in the early 1990s, are those still there?
No, those look a little more messy. And perhaps if those were created by whirlwinds or plasmas or even balls of light or something, they tend to be messier looking. You know, for the longest time, I wanted to know the same thing like you did, Deborah. I wanted to say, what's the difference between the ones that were made by people and that weren't? I have to tell you, I haven't seen enough that were not man-made to compare, apart from that one I showed you from Westbury, from the Hill, that looked kind of crop circle-like. I feel probably all the ones I saw since I only got involved in 97, I think those have all been man-made. And it's something I never would have thought back then, but I don't have anything to compare it to. So there weren't very many of those other type. The reason that there were so many is there were like about 40 people making them at one point from about 96 through about 2006. There were a lot of groups out there, secret groups, and that's the ones that we saw. So if there's ever a farmer that wants to let us use their land and make some of these and have all sorts, you know, here's a kind of a disadvantage we have. We can't go in those fields really without the permission of the farmer as tourists. They can kick you off, and many of them don't want people walking on their land anymore because it damages the crop. So we can't really be out there very much. I'd love to bring different, you know, experiment, make them in different ways. We could do a different intentionality experiments and make them, but you need wheat and fields to do that, and it costs money to do it. Those fields that we rented would be $500 to $1,000 per field. That's how much they told us wheat they would be losing. So we would pay them anywhere up $500 and upward to use a field. So we'd like
Thank
to compare
you.
It, yeah. But we just need, it's just like any other science. You need like a structure and funding to be able to do it properly. Yeah.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead.
Oh, hi. Okay. This is Nancy. I'm in Philadelphia.
Hey.
I just wanted to chime in. I belong to the American Association of Dowsers, and we were talking about creating labyrinths and a labyrinth project. And they had done these outside a hospital, and the data showed that people on that wing of the hospital tended to heal and get better and get released much faster. I was also told that when they build a labyrinth, which looks very much like a crop circle, that it is perceivable by radar from the air. Now, I don't have any data on this. I was just listening. I'm just kind of chiming in with a little bit of information that I have. But I'm suggesting that quite possibly in that pattern, in that organization of space, that there is an energy created that could be researched. You wouldn't need wheat. It could just be done on the ground, because that's what dowsers are interested in, is sensing and detecting energy forms inherent in the ground and emanating from the ground.
Right. You know, that's really good, Nancy. There are a lot of people that douse the circles and use dowsing methods to detect the energy. And
right.
What you're suggesting is maybe it's not even the wheat. Maybe it's the shape itself that creates the energy. You don't need them. You know, this is what Art Bell asked me when I did an interview with him many years ago, right? He said, could we do it without the wheat? Would we see the same effect? Could you put smoke above the pattern and see a slight change in the smoke patterns, right? Or some other effect there. It's fascinating. Don't you think there's a lot of research we can do? And one other thing that your question is kind of making me think of is, you know, the circles have different feelings to them. And some of them make you feel really good, and you would imagine they have a healing effect, and some don't. I don't know why. Some of them you go in and you just get an icky feeling, and some you go in and you feel great. So I imagine you could design them. What was that?
All the ones that are negative, geopathic zones.
Right.
And they can clearly be sensed. And others are attractors, and they are very positive, and they attract people to them, and they're very healing.
Exactly. So this is obviously part of a larger subject of shapes and energy that you dowsers are familiar with.
Wish I were.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that's a good question. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Sim?
Yeah.
Hi, Sim. Sam, this is John with a quick question.
Hey, John.
Have you looked into the snow patterns? I saw a couple of videos of snow crops, snow circles. You know?
Yeah, the snow circles. No, those are pretty neat looking, aren't they?
Yeah.
I don't know too much about them. I mean, I haven't seen any myself, and I think there were some from Switzerland or somewhere. They looked great, didn't they? They're like really neat looking. And you do find people making these patterns here and there in different ways. People have made these in the desert sometimes, you know, and I think there were some in Death Valley or some. I saw Oregon. Wasn't there one in Oregon which was made in rocks and things? But you can get similar types of shapes in snow, and I can't comment on those. I just don't have much experience with anything else. But I haven't even seen a sand circle personally, so so far to me it's just grain crops.
Okay, thanks. Great presentation, by the way. Really terrific.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, glad you liked it. Yeah. You could blame Courtney. Okay. It's funny how these topics connect from one to the next. I have to tell you folks, I'm not one person that just stayed in one area. I'm fascinated by all of this, and I love to, just like all of you, I try to get to the bottom of some of this. I feel like there's a lot we don't know about how all of this works, but it makes this a lot for us to investigate, right? There's a lot to investigate.
Yeah.
And I think it's...
There are a lot of questions in the chat. I don't know if you want to take a look at those.
Oh, okay, sure. Let me take a look. I had that window closed.
I was wondering if anyone has remote viewed the crop circles, like had projects where they had viewers view a few of the different ones.
You know, the viewing I did with my groups in England, we just did pretty much CRV training when I was there. And I actually wanted them not to view the circles. I'm just saying in my own work with it, because I wanted them just to learn RV for the first time with regular, I mean, like, just like calibration targets. So I would say, this is not a crop circle. This is something else. And I would give them, you know, pictures from magazines and so forth, the way a lot of us were trained in the beginning. So I actually haven't done, there have been, let me put it this way, Deborah, there have been intention experiments there. We went over, Roger Nelson was part of our group, by the way, in 2006. Roger Nelson from Pear Labs, who you might have seen at SSE meeting, Society for Scientific Exploration. And we went in there with his random number generators, the eggs. And we did get some results around some of the circles, but it wasn't statistically significant. It's the type of thing you'd want to do a lot more of to see if you found any patterns. We did global meditations once where people were meditating literally at the same time in different parts of the globe during the solstice, things like this, or particular dates. But I actually haven't done, apart from giving crop circles to viewers in my own RV classes from time to time, like on the last day, as a kind of esoteric target, just to see what people got. I didn't show you many of those, but they were quite good, some of them. People reproduced the shapes somewhat. They picked up that there was anomalous energy there. I've had this happen many times. So I've given it to viewers individually as targets, but not as a group project. So it's a good idea. Let me just mention, since I saw a question, if you do ever want to get in contact with me, I am, you know, I have obviously have the YouTube channel. You can put my name in to see my videos about this. My blog is newcrystalmind.com, newcrystalmind.com, and there's a contact form there to contact me anytime you want. And you can go to my websites and see my email, just like someone put here, simeon@mountbaldy.com. So if you don't want to get in contact, that's how you do it. But anyway, that's a good idea, Deborah, these are all good ideas. Who knows what we would find with a group project. I did mention that people have gotten together on hilltops and meditated with the intention of creating a certain shape, and sometimes those showed up. At least we know in one case it was a circle maker who felt like he should go out and make that shape. But Matt felt just compelled that that was an RV type of related, RV-related effect. He just thought it was so strange that showed up in his mind. He feels compelled to go out and make it by himself. He normally works with a group, and there people are meditating on it just so close by. It's fascinating.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, it suggests, Deborah, that this is a common channel of information. It's not all, you know, I'm not a person that thinks these are all separate phenomena. I think at some level there's something that connects all of this that I don't thoroughly understand yet. Perhaps nobody does. But it's a channel of information, and you can tap into it in different ways. We do it through RV. You can do it through crop circles, too, perhaps.
Simeon, let me make a comment here.
Yeah, go ahead.
We certainly don't understand it. And yet, it does seem like consciousness seems to be the most fundamental thing we can think of.
Yeah.
And I had this interesting thought when you were talking about the patterns with the wheat. You were thinking of it, and of course we all saw the patterns in physical space. The wheat is a living entity. I wonder what the pattern would look like in some sort of yet-to-be-understood consciousness space.
Yep.
If consciousness is the fundamental, then what could be picked up and what could be, boy, you talk about hypotheses, right? But what could be activating your light bulbs could in fact be something at this consciousness level, which we're all struggling to understand. And just as you said, precognition, remote viewing, a lot of other anomalous phenomenon that are indeed real, maybe somehow it ought to help us understand this consciousness space better.
Yeah.
So.
Absolutely, Marty. And, you know, I know Bill Tiller has talked about this, you know? He had the idea of a direct space and a reciprocal space, an energy space that is the counterpart to the physical world that we live in. And it relates to cymatics, you know, shapes and energy.
Yeah.
And that there's a correlate in the energy world and in consciousness to physical reality that we can't see it, but we obviously have a lot of evidence that it's there, right? And this could be another, you know, to get back to some of your other questions that people have asked so far, that the shape interacts with our consciousness in an interesting way. So, yeah, so that's a good point.
And let me just relate this to your liquid crystals, which I found fascinating, that that's sort of where, you know, you're leaning in terms of trying to understand this. That was really a fascinating connection with it not being perfect. It was just like our physical senses tend to pick up gradients, liquid crystals and, you know, crop circles and stuff like that. It's like, I really do think these are hints for us in maybe eventually putting together a physics-like model of consciousness. And you're bringing in the dark energy. I've often wondered if dark energy and dark matter are indeed directly connected to consciousness in some way.
Yeah.
But both of us, and I think almost everybody in this field that is sort of thinking about this from the science standpoint as well as being involved in doing it, have these hypotheses, and what to do with the next step is what's tough. you know, how can we use this in a way, I don't know, to illuminate knowledge and knowledge about consciousness.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll stop.
It's true, Marty, and we have a long ways to go, but it's exciting that we're actually at the beginning of this, right? We're really at the beginning of it, and we're playing with it, as someone said, right?
And that's exactly right.
We don't know what all the knobs and the parameters are, but we can see that the effects are there. So it's like a support to keep moving in the direction that you're moving in. You know, I once read that in a history of science, someone had a quote. They said that the mistake a lot of scientists make is they don't believe in their ideas enough, right? Mm-hmm. It's too easy mm-hmm. to stop and go back. And if you're just so close, if you just pushed it a little farther. So the message here is that we should all have confidence in whatever level that we're dealing with this type of reality. I mean, don't give up. Keep pushing it, because you're going to get a very interesting result that should, you know, keep you going for quite a while. And maybe all of these will come together, Marty, in another model that's more compelling and more satisfying than the one we've been working with. Right. So, but anyway, I'm going to have to depart at this moment to have another event that I have to go to in a few minutes. But I really enjoyed this, and let's do it again sometime. And feel free, if any of you want to contact me for any reason, I'm here. So.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Thanks for coming in. We'll talk to you soon. Okay.
Okay. Bye bye.
Okay. Bye bye.
Take care.
Bye. Thanks, Marty. Bye bye.
Bye. Okay. Well, that was
wow. That was amazing.
Really interesting, huh?
Totally amazing.